All right, so it turns out that there's going to be a useful step here, which is we're going to take advantage of the fact that minus epsilon is greater than or equal to the natural log of 1 minus epsilon, which maybe is not so obvious. But if you plot it, you can see that it's true. If this is the epsilon axis, then minus epsilon looks like a straight line going down like that.
Sure, it's got slope minus 1.
Yep. And the log of 1 minus epsilon looks like this. It starts off... They're totally lined up at zero, at epsilon zero.
Sure. Because 1 minus 0 is 1, the natural log of 1 is 0.
Exactly. And then what happens is it starts to fall away from it. The slope is actually, you can test this by taking the derivative of it, but the slope is, it's monotonically changing in this way so that it falls away from the line. It always stays below it. Okay? So if we believe that, which, I'm going to just say calculus.
Well, you can kind of see that, right? Because when epsilon is 1, that would be the natural log of 0. And the only way you can raise e to a power and get 0 is by having effectively negative infinity.
Yeah, so, right. By then, it's definitely below. But it stays below all along. I mean, because just that is not enough.
It has to stay below all along because the natural log is a monotonic function, right? So it can't, get bigger and then get smaller again. So, yeah, okay, I buy that.
Good. All right, so if that's the case, if we accept this line, then it's also going to be the case that 1 minus epsilon to the m is less than or equal to e to the minus epsilon m. So why is that? So if you multiply both sides by m and then take e to the both sides, you get exactly this expression.
Sure.
All right? So now that we've gotten that, we can use it here in our derivation and rewrite that as the size of the hypothesis space times e to the minus epsilon m, right? That gives us another upper bound on the quantities that we had before. And this is much more convenient to work with. The epsilon, which had been kind of trapped in the parentheses with the 1 minus, now comes up to the exponent where we can work with it better.
Sure.
All right, so what this is an upper bound that the version space is not epsilon exhausted after m samples.
Mm.
And that is what we would like delta to. We would like delta to be a bound on that,
mm-hmm.
right? So the delta is the failure probability essentially. So the failure probability ought to be bigger than or equal to this expression here.
Okay.
All right. So now the last thing we need to do is we can just rewrite this in terms of m.
Mm.
So if we do that, let's see what happens. All right, so when we're done rewriting that, what we find is the sample size m needs to be at least as large as 1 over epsilon times the quantity, the log of the size of the hypothesis space plus the log of 1 over delta.
Okay, and that is polynomial in 1 over epsilon, 1 over delta, and the size of the hypothesis space.
Indeed.
Nice.
So that's pretty cool.
So cool.
Right. So it tells us if you know the size of your hypothesis space and you know what your epsilon and delta targets are, sample a bunch and then you'll be okay.
That's pretty good.